Take your Bible this evening, if you would, please, and go to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, please. Ephesians chapter 4 for our scripture reading tonight. Three verses to read this evening, verses 30, 31, and 32. Let's read 30 together, and I'll read 31, then let's end together on verse number 32 of Ephesians chapter 4. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin on verse 30 of Ephesians chapter 4. Ready? "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you." And let's pray, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this evening. Lord, we're asking that you would continue to make our hearts ready to receive the truth from your word tonight. Thank you already, Lord, for such a wonderful service. It sure has been good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Lord, I pray that you'll continue to please make our hearts ready to receive your word tonight. We want it to be good ground that the word of God can fall into and bring forth fruit in our lives. And so, Lord, bless the special now as they sing. In Jesus' name, amen.
I carried a burden, a staggering weight, and struggled for freedom but could not escape. I trembled and cried at the thought of my fate. What must I do to be saved? I desperately searched for release from my pain, but found that man's wisdom was useless and vain. Is there not a power that can break every chain? What must I do to be saved? Jesus' blood flows from Calvary, breaking Satan's power, setting
Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer now as we come to the preaching of your word. Again, Lord, we want to thank you tonight for the Bible. Thank you, Lord, for giving us your word, the words of God. We don't believe they're just the words of man or the words of men, but we believe this to be the very words of God. And Lord, we want them to be effectual in our life tonight, and I pray, God, that you would help us and open our understanding as we go through the scripture this evening, and as we share some things about the family of God that would be helpful, would be encouraging to the people of God in this place. So help me as I bring the message and help each individual as they listen. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. This doesn't seem quite right, Dean, so check this for me, would you? Make sure it's where it's supposed to be, and it might just be my voice isn't quite what it is. Having to do all the singing as well, all right? Now, when we're born again, the Bible says we become new creatures in Christ. How many are familiar with the verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. And it says, behold, old things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new. All right? All things are new. What do we get new when we get saved? Well, you get a new father. All right? Before you get saved, your father is the devil. Maybe you didn't know that, but you know it now. All right? And aren't you glad you got a new father when you got saved? Now your father is God. You get a new name. You get a name Christian. You're now a follower of Jesus Christ. And you get a new name when you're born again, when you become in Christ. You get new friends. And by the way, that's one of the important things you need to do as you begin to live for God. You have to understand those who do not love the Lord will not help you serve the Lord. And so those so-called friends that want you to go away from God and do the things that doesn't please God, you have to get new friends. And thank God you get new friends when you come to Christ. You get a new direction in life. We talked about in our 5:30 class, you do not follow the flesh anymore. You follow the Spirit. You do not just do what you want. Now it comes into play. You must do what God wants. And God begins to direct your life. And you get a new direction. But something else you get. By the way, you got a new destination too. You're no longer headed for hell. You're headed for heaven. And heaven will be your destination. Amen. And so we get all these things new, but there's something else you get when you get saved, when you're in Christ, and that is you get a new family. You get a new family. In Ephesians 4, the verse we read tonight, notice verse number 32. And be ye kind one to another. That word kind there is a shortened. If you put a R-E-D with kind, what word do you get? Kindred. Be ye like kindred. What's kindred? Yeah, kin. All right, what's a fancy? Kin is West Virginia for family, all right? And you just ain't going to see my kin folk, amen? And yeah, talking Bob's language now, brother. And so it's like kin. So he's saying, be like kin one to another. Be like family one to another. That's why we refer to people here as our church family. It's our church family. That's why we refer to it as the family of God. We sing on Sunday morning, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. And what does it mean to be part of the family? I want to talk just to our church family, just a message to help you understand just what it means to be part of God's family, what it means to be part of your church family. All right, and what does that mean? I'm going to give you six simple statements tonight, and we'll talk a little bit about each one. What it means to be kin one to another. It means this, number one, that every family member is unique and necessary. Every family member is unique and necessary. How many of you have more than one child? I don't care if they're grown or not, you've had more than one child, okay? Many people here. How many of you would agree you don't ever have two children that are exactly alike? Am I right? Everyone's unique, aren't they? Everyone's different. And everyone's necessary. Okay? And you love every one of them. As the child begins to grow, they each begin to exhibit their own personality traits. One may be very giggly, and the other one may be very serious. Okay? One's very active and moving, and the other one may be very slow and deliberate. One may like hugs, and another one may not care for hugs. Every child is different. One may love to go to bed, and the other one just wants to stay up and never wants to go to bed. And they're just different. They're unique, and they're necessary. And it's no different with God's family. All right? Everyone is different. Everyone's unique, and yet everyone's necessary. You have some folks that are that may be very quiet and very reserved, you know, and we have folks like that, you know. There's a, and you know, Jim Talladay, very quiet. Right? Now, sometimes he cuts up with his wife and I catch him down there, but, you know, he's most of the part, he's pretty quiet, and you don't ever hear much from him. And other men that I think of as I just look around, you know, I think Brian Campbell, and they're not here tonight, they're ill, but he's very quiet. Brother Jason's quiet. I know your family may debate that, but he's very quiet. And you know what? And there's other men like that. We need that. Then there's other men we have that aren't so quiet. Okay? They're more boisterous. They're more apt to speak out and say something, like Brother Abrams. Okay? Like Brother Wright. Down here, amen. And Brother Quentin. Okay? But you know what? We need them. We need all of them. They're all unique and they're all necessary to what? To the family. And so we all, they're all needed, they're all necessary. Different personalities. And you know what? God is the one who gives us our personalities. And so they've been given to us by God. And there's, you want to be frustrated, try to be like somebody you're not. Boy, that's frustrating. And you just can't be that way. And you have to be who God made you to be. You were created by God, and you're needed by God. You know, Jesus chose the 12 disciples, and we'll refer to this a few times tonight, and they were all so very different. And, you know, John was one who would lean on his breast at supper time. As most of you know, they didn't sit at a table. They had a very low table to the ground, and they would kind of lay on their side and maybe prop their hand up, and they kind of laid that way to eat. And not utensils. Most of them use, and just like they do in India, they use like bread or something, and they dip things and they eat that. I remember over in India, the Indians don't use utensils. They just have bread and things, and they just dip the food on that, and they eat it that way. Sometimes they use their fingers and dip it up and eat it. And so, listen, so John would lean on his breast. But listen, if all 12 disciples leaned on his breast, he'd be in trouble. That would hurt. Okay, get off, you know. But everybody's different. And the Lord made us that way. And that's okay. That's all right. It ought to be, we talked this morning in Sunday school, remember, about the cross-section of people that were in the church at Colossae. And how different they all were. Old and young and single and married and all different sorts of, as I think Brother Taylor mentioned, different ethnic groups and different, listen, we're all one in Christ. And it's okay to be unique, but you're still necessary. So all of us are unique, and we're all necessary. But now, number two, let me give you this statement. Every family member is accepted as they are. Every family member is accepted as they are. We're different, but we're accepted as different. That's okay. Peter was rough and tough and outspoken. John was quiet and gentle and contemplative, but they were both chosen by Jesus to be his disciples. So we accept everybody where they are. Hey, that means long hair, short hair. That means facial hair, no facial hair. It means tattooed or not tattooed, pierced or not pierced. Modestly dressed or immodestly dressed. We well-educated or functionally illiterate. We accept people as they are. You accept people as they are. You accept them where they are. Okay? Now, so everyone's unique. Everybody's necessary. Number two, we accept every family member as they are. Let me give you number three. However, every family member is seeking to improve. Every family member seeks to improve. And that means we all are seeking to grow spiritually. The Bible says we're to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As newborn babes, to desire the sincere milk of the word that ye may grow thereby. In Ephesians, it talks about how we're growing up into Him. Okay, we're maturing in the Christian life. And so that means change. You know what happens when you grow? You change. Right? Nathan, Moreland is growing. Have you noticed that? Kids all legs. Now, you may not notice it as much as mom and dad notice it. You know why? They try to keep him in clothes. He gets on, he'll put on a pair of pants and it'll be like this, you know. They'll say, man, those just fit him last week, didn't they? Huh? You feel that way? Huh? What's that mean? He's changing, and as he changes, as he grows, he changes. Okay? His voice changes. Huh? Isn't that right, Dad? Huh? Yeah, are we going to church tonight, Dad? You know, I remember those days when your voice sometimes is in and out and going. Changes take place. And listen, as you grow in Christ, as folks come, and they come and they're accepted just as they are. You come to Christ just as you are. Then you begin to grow. You begin to improve. You know what that means? Changes begin to happen. Changes begin to take place. Let me illustrate it this way. There, years ago, wow, I was thinking about this as I wrote this down. I think it was, I might have been early 20s, but I think I was still a teenager. We had an evangelist come to our church. And he told the illustration of his 11-year-old daughter. I don't remember how fast the car was going, but I remember somehow she opened the door and she fell out of the car. Horrible road burn, road rash, injuries to her. And as a result of that, she had burns, especially on her hands, and she had hurt her leg, and she had to wear these thick gloves on her hands as her hands were healing and trying to get new skin and grafts and such on her hands. And I remember him talking about her leg, and it twisted or turned, and they had to put a big metal brace on it to keep it straight until it would continue to be straight on its own. And she had developed an inner ear problem, and it hurt her hearing, and so she had to wear these hearing aids on her ears. Now, can you imagine what an 11-year-old girl felt like? She felt pretty ugly. And as I listened to the evangelist tell the story that day, he said that she felt very ugly and unlovable, and he said one day she took off the hearing aids, took off the heavy gloves, took off the brace from her leg, and she, in tears, said to her daddy, "Nobody loves me this way." And he took her up in his arms and he said, "Oh, sweetheart, I love you just the way you are. But I want you to wear these things. Because as much as I love you the way you are, I love you too much to let you stay this way. I love you too much to let you stay this way." And that's why we love folks where they are, but we love you too much to let you stay where you are. We want you to grow. We want you to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In the family of God, you're loved and accepted as you are, but you're loved too much by God for Him to let you stay that way. He is going to develop you, and He's going to help you to become more like Christ. And so each of our desire ought to be to have God change us. God, make me like Christ. Conform me to the image of your Son. And like Brother Taylor testified tonight, that may be certain people coming into our life to shape us, to have us work on a certain fruit of the Spirit that will yield to the Spirit in that area. And maybe He's trying to teach us long-suffering. Maybe He's trying to work on our gentleness. Maybe He's trying to work on our meekness, our temperance. And He's trying to develop that in us. And so, God, I want you to grow me. God, I want you to change me. Grow me in knowledge. Grow me in love. Grow me in compassion. Grow me in prayer. Grow me in faithfulness. Grow me in separation from the world. Grow me to have a closer walk with you. God, I want that change in my life. See, so while every family is unique, every family member is unique and necessary, every family member is accepted as they are, every family member also seeks to improve. We seek to grow and to be like Christ. That's part of being the family of God. Let me give you statement four. Every family member knows other family members' faults. Some of you are smiling. You're thinking of your own family, aren't you? Huh? Every parent knows this feeling. Every parent knows the feeling when your kids have been somewhere, someone else has watched them, and you go to pick them up, and they say, "Your kids are just the sweetest, most obedient kids I've ever had." And when that happens, every parent thinks, "You don't live with them. You don't live with them. You don't know them like I know them." Huh? You've had that feeling, haven't you? You think, man, if you could be that good, who are you? You need to be that way at home. You understand? When the problem is this. When you live with them, you see the good, but you also see the bad and the ugly. Because you live with them. And you get to see it all. Now, what happens in a church, listen, the folks who you just see on Sunday morning and say, "Hi, how are you? Good to see you." You know what? They're going to think you're wonderful. Because they don't know you. Okay? Here's the problem. We see each other on Sunday morning and Sunday night. And by the way, when you see some on Sunday morning, you're here early maybe for Sunday school, and you're here for Sunday school and then for church, and then some involved in different music ministries and such, they're here at 4 o'clock in the afternoon on Sunday. Some of you know you don't come till 6:30 for church. There's some folks been here since 4 o'clock. And they're here at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock choir practice, 6:30 church, and, you know, we don't get out till 9 o'clock. And I'm kidding. We won't be out that long, and it'll be 5 till 9. But listen. You're here for hours, and then some come back on Tuesday night for School of the Bible. Some are back here on Wednesday night for the midweek service. Some of us are together on Thursday night for the prison. Some are all together here on Friday night for Reformers Unanimous. Some of us are here on Saturday morning to go out soul winning and visiting. You think about it. Some of us see each other 6 days a week. And you know what happens when you see somebody 6 days a week? You get to see the good, the bad, and the ugly. You get to see faults. You get to know folks. And then you have to, you know, it's amazing. Would you just remember that don't be shocked when you discover that everybody's human? Sometimes we get so surprised when somebody says something or reacts a certain way, and we're like, "Oh, wow, I can't believe they..." Did you think they weren't human? Everybody's human. Your pastor's human. You pinch that, and I'll say, "Ouch." Okay? And we all are. I tell folks all the time, you won't come here long, but I'll disappoint you. Okay? I'm good at that. I can do that without trying. Okay? And it happens. I don't want it to, but it will happen. But you have a human being for a pastor. And I've been down the road long enough now to realize I got human beings that I pastor. Okay? And so I'm not surprised or ever shocked when someone's just being a human being. Human beings say things they shouldn't say. Human beings sometimes take things that other people say in a wrong way and take offense to something they shouldn't take offense for. That someone didn't mean that at all, but they feel that way. You know, Christians in the Bible had disagreements. As they got to know one another, they had disagreements, and I'll talk more about this in a minute. And by the way, it weren't just those two women in Philippi, Euodias and Syntyche or whatever her name was. I never can get those names quite right. Harry Ironside, years ago, he was a pastor years ago at the Moody Church and a great Bible expository. He called those two ladies Euodias and Syntyche. And I never got over that, and so I always want to call him that when I think of those two ladies. We're not just talking about two ladies in the church. We're talking about somebody like Paul and Barnabas, two of the first missionaries of the Christian church, the first missionaries. They had disagreement. They had a problem, all right? And so realize, don't be shocked when you find out that somebody's human. Don't be shocked when you find out somebody else has some faults, has some flaws, has some things that they're, that you're, why are we surprised? Okay? We've all sinned and come short. We all come short of the glory of God. So just allow for that. You do that in your family. You do that in your family. And so, and when you know a family, another family member has a fault or has a flaw, you don't go broadcast out to everybody. You don't do that. You keep it in your family. Okay? It just stays there. And that's the way it should be. All right? Every family member is unique and necessary. Every family member is accepted as they are. Every family member seeks to improve. Every family member knows the other member's faults. Let me give you statement 5. Family members work out the differences or they avoid them. There's 2 ways to deal with any problem or difficulty. All right? Number 1, resolve it. Okay? Get it settled. Let's turn in your Bible to Acts 15, would you? Acts chapter 15. In Acts 15, what you have here is what's called the Council at Jerusalem. Paul and Barnabas have come back from their missionary journey, and they're called into question by some of the bigwigs in Jerusalem. And what has happened is they were saying that these Gentile people that you've seen saved, they need to keep the law of Moses in order to be saved. They have to be circumcised, or they have to do certain rituals. They have to do that in addition to faith in Christ. They also have to do this in order to be saved. And Paul basically said, "You're crazy, man. Don't put those things on Gentile believers. That's not right." So what do they have? A conflict. They have a difference. And so they meet, different ones talk, different ones say what they want. Look down at verse number 20. Here's the conclusion they say. Here's what we're going to do. Well, let's look at verse 19. It says, "Wherefore my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God." Excuse me. "But that we write unto them that they abstain from pollutions of idols, from fornication, from things strangled, and from blood." So they said, "We're going to, here's all they got to do." These 4 things we're asking them to do. All right? And they, what'd they do? They resolved the issue. They came to an agreement they both could agree on, and they resolved it. Now, sometimes you have to agree to disagree and move on. Okay? That was the case with Paul and Barnabas, wasn't it? Remember that they were getting ready to go on the second missionary journey, and John Mark had left at some point in the first missionary journey and went home. Now they're back. They've reported to the church. They say, "You know what? We ought to go back and check on the churches and see how they're doing." Barnabas said, "Great idea. I'll go get John Mark." And Paul said, "You're going to do what?" He said, "I'm going to go get John Mark." He says, "You'll do no such thing." "What do you mean I'll do no such thing? He's my sister's son. He's my nephew. He's got to come with us." "No, he doesn't. He's a quitter. He quit on the journey. I'm not going to get out there this time and have him get homesick and go back home. He's not going." All this is in the Greek. You got to understand all this. You know, it's not in English. But and listen, the Bible says there was sharp dissension between them. Say, how sharp did it get? Barnabas says, "If he ain't going, I'm not going." Paul said, "Fine, you're not going." And Paul chose Silas. And Silas went on the next missionary journey. Barnabas took John Mark and went back home. They never resolved it. They just agreed to disagree. But here's the great thing about it. Barnabas didn't go and start a crusade against Paul. He didn't even badmouth Paul to John Mark. I don't know what he said, but later on, in fact, we read it in Colossians this morning. We talked about Marcus concerning whom, and he said, if he comes to you, receive him. Later on, he said, bring John Mark, for he's profitable to me for the ministry. Later on, Paul wanted John to come and work, or Mark to come and work with him and help him. That would have never happened if Barnabas, all he did was get on a crusade and blast Paul the whole way. He didn't do that. One of the greatest things you learn in life is when you're hurt, to stop the hurt with you. You know what we usually do? We pass it on to somebody else. Sometimes when somebody says something hurtful to you, would you just step back and realize That's because they've been hurt, and so they're trying to pass the hurt on to somebody else. But you know what you find out? You never cure your hurt by trying to hurt somebody else. You only make it worse. Just let the hurt stop with you, and you'll find that healing begins to take place much sooner. Let it stop with you. So he didn't badmouth, and later on, John Mark worked with Paul. Paul said this in 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 5, I suppose I was not a whit behind the chiefest of the apostles. A whit, W-H-I-T, is the smallest part or particle imaginable. Okay? He said, so I suppose I wasn't altogether behind everything. Listen, what was he saying? Good men can disagree. But you don't have to be disagreeable. We've lost that in our country, where people can just agree to disagree, but try to find areas where you can get along. So sometimes you resolve it, and sometimes you resolve it by solving it. Sometimes you resolve it by saying, "We're going to move on. You go your way, and I'll go mine." The second thing you do is you avoid it. How do you deal with a problem or a difficulty? You avoid it. Romans 16 and verse 15. Romans 16 and verse 15. That's not it. Romans 16, verse 17. How's that? Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. The word avoid there is the same word. We get our word detour. And here, of course, he's talking about doctrinally, someone who would cause divisions or offensive that is contrary to doctrine. And he said, you need to detour around those people. Don't go near them. Go around them. Don't have anything to do with them. Some things you know that you're not going to solve. And if you're not going to solve it, you just learn to detour around it and let it go. Okay? Give me an example. We have family members that are saved people, love the Lord, but they're not King James Bible people. Okay? But they love God. Some are even missionaries on a foreign field. And they love the Lord. When we get together, I don't say, hey, come over here, let me show you why I believe the King James Bible. We don't talk about that. You know what we talk about? We avoid that subject, and we talk about Jesus and people getting saved and lives being changed and what the Lord's doing and answers to prayer. We avoid the subject that we know isn't going to be resolved. You understand? And sometimes you're going to have folks like that. There's going to be certain things in a family you're not going to resolve, so you learn to detour around it. You learn to avoid it. And it doesn't need to be talked about. It doesn't need to be confronted. You're not going to solve that. So you avoid that. You focus on the things you do agree on. And focus on those things. So often, see, Satan's, from the garden, how many trees could Adam and Eve eat of? All of them except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What did Satan get her to focus on? One. Isn't that what he does with us? And we don't focus on all the things we agree on. We focus on the one thing we don't agree on. There's so many other things you could talk about and you could fellowship over and you can agree about. Why would you focus on the one thing you know is going to be a disagreement? Don't do that. Avoid that. Detour around that. Tell you what you don't do. When you have a disagreement in your family, you don't go find another family. When you have a disagreement with your spouse, you don't go find another spouse. Hello? And when you have a disagreement with somebody in your church family, you don't go find another church. You don't go find another family. You either can resolve it or you avoid it. You detour around it. and you learn to let it go. So every family member is unique and necessary. Every family member is accepted as they are. Every family member will be seeking to improve, to grow. Every family member knows each other's faults. And every family member will seek one another's good. Will seek one another good. One another's good. The Bible says, Philippians 2, verse 4, look not every man on his own things, but every man on the things of others. And it doesn't mean, you know, look at what they got and I don't have. No, he's not talking about that. He's saying, focus on what someone else needs, not what you need. Focus that someone else on someone else's good and not whether anybody's doing good to me. Bible says, you don't focus on whether you have any friends, you focus on you being friendly. And a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. It's always the emphasis in the Bible. So when we get saved, we're no longer out to please us. All the advertising you see on television, why? It's all about you. You deserve this, and you need this, and I ought to have this. And that's the whole thing. Well, I get on the protesters again, don't I? But you know what I mean? It's all just selfishness. Selfishness. Me, me, me. You know, get all upset because I get all upset because I was hoping the Atlanta Falcons would beat the New England Patriots in the Super Bowl. And I felt pretty good. We went out to get something with the Jarvises after last Sunday night. And I looked up at that screen in the restaurant and it was 28-3. And I thought, yeah, I'm getting it handed to them. Got home and turned it on and it was 28-12 and then 28-20 and then 28-28. Oh, no. I wanted to put up on Facebook. I want to go out and run down the street with a sign, not my Super Bowl champion. Huh? Wouldn't that be selfish? I mean, that's how silly it is. Throw a rock through my neighbor's window or something, you know? Do something to let everybody know how mad I am? No, by the way, if I did that and I set fire to something in my neighbor's yard or busted out his windows, you know where I'd be? You'd be getting a phone call. Come get me out, you know. I'd be arrested. And that's exactly what they ought to do to every one of those protesters. Boy, how did that get into this message? But there it was. There it was. So when you come, we're looking out for someone else's good. When you come to church, you're not just coming for you. You're coming for others. You're not just coming to be blessed, you're coming to be a blessing. You're coming to not just what you can get, you're coming for what you can give. What can you contribute to the service and to others? I've asked this before, but how many of you are, when you come to church, you look for certain people that you like to talk to when you come to church? Are you like that? Yeah, look at that. And when they look around to see and they say, oh, they're not here. It's a disappointment. Oh, they're not here. I was looking forward to seeing them. I was looking forward to talking with them. So when you get to thinking like, it doesn't matter if I go, I don't get anything out from that guy anymore. Huh? I hope you don't say that, but if you feel that way, come because you can be a blessing to somebody else. You probably won't be if you have that kind of an attitude, but you know, try to come to be a blessing. Come for what you can contribute, not just what you're going to get from it. You come to be a blessing. Used to be a sign that I saw, like a plaque said, home, where you've seen it too, where each lives for the other and all live for God. Home, where each lives for the other and all live for God. That pretty well defines a church family too. Where each lives for the other and all live for God. In a family, you defend one another. You defend your brother. You defend your sister. You ought to defend your brothers and sisters in your church family. You don't talk bad about one another. You don't talk bad about your family outside the family. And you don't need to talk bad about inside the family. We love unconditionally. That means no strings attached. You don't have to do anything to earn love. You're just loved unconditionally as God loves us. Means means you're not on trial. You're not on trial. That's what Satan tried to get Job to do. Yeah, you love God. Hey, God, he loves you because you don't let anything bad happen to him. You're just on trial and you've passed all the tests, but if you just cross him and go against him sometime, then we'll see what happens. You know the story. Job said, the Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, God's not on trial. I love God, whether he gives me things, whether he doesn't give me anything. Whether he gives it to me or takes it all away. He said, I'm loving God no matter what. It doesn't matter. And that's the way we're supposed to love God. That's the way we're supposed to love each other. Even as God, even as Christ loved the church, even as God so loved us. So you're a family member. And when you're a family member, you're loved. Period. Unconditionally accepted. Well, let's review. Number one, every family member is unique and necessary. Number two, every family member is accepted as they are. But number three, we said every family member seeks to improve and to grow in their Christian walk. Number four, every family member knows one another's faults. Every family member works out the differences or learns to avoid them, leaves a detour around them, and don't make it an issue. And number six, every family member seeks one another's good. I'm not just in it for my good, I'm in it for other people's good. I want to be a blessing to somebody else, not just myself. I don't know about you. I'm glad I'm a part of the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family. That's low. The family of God. Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you for our church family. Thank you, Lord, for the people who you have brought to this place. And Lord, we sure are grateful that you're our Father. This is your church. This is our church family. We call each other brother and sister. And Lord, I pray that tonight each one would understand their role in the family. That we're all unique, but we're all necessary. Lord, we're here. And we realize we're all human beings. We'll disappoint one another at times. We'll come short of meeting expectations at times. But Lord, help us to be kind, like kin one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven us. Father, I pray that you've used the truths tonight to help us. Help us each to seek to improve and to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. And allow you to continue to work in our lives and to conform us all to be more like Jesus. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer here in just a moment and we'll have our invitation. I wonder how many folks tonight would just say, Preacher, that God spoke to my heart tonight. The Spirit of God stopped at my seat for sure. And he spoke to me about some things this evening, about being part of the family of God. Preacher, pray for me this evening. God spoke to my heart. Will you slip your hand up and say, pray for me, Pastor? God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart. Then respond to him tonight, will you? Take a few minutes before we leave and just bow the knee and talk to the Lord about what he's spoken to you about. And maybe just bow the knee and say, I'm thankful I'm a part of the family of God. Heavenly Father, bless this invitation time. I pray, God, that your will be done in each heart and life. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for giving us a church family that we can grow together with and serve you together with. I pray your blessing now in the invitation. May each of us do what you're bidding us to do in our heart. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, Lisa will play. As she plays the invitation tonight, God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this evening. Will you please? That's right. Sing the chorus with her, will you? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Father, we thank You now for today. Thank You, Lord, for decisions that have been made for You throughout the day today. Thank You, Lord, for our church family. Thank You for our earthly families that You've blessed us with. And thank You, God, for our church family. And I pray Your blessing upon each individual tonight as they leave this place. And may they realize, and Lord, may we all go home rejoicing in our heart that we're part of the family of God. Thank You for being our Father. Thank You for loving us. Thank You for giving us a good day in Your house. And Father, we pray for those, again, ill and out of the services today. Please put Your healing hand upon them. Raise them up and bring them back with us by Wednesday night. Lord, I do pray for those who are overseas right now, Brother Yoder, Brother Fowler. Lord, as they're preparing to go about their work on Monday, I pray, God, that Your hand of blessing will be upon them and they'll have a fruitful day serving You there. And Lord, we pray for the Jarvises and down in Honduras. You'll give them a fruitful time as well. And as they begin to prepare for language school, that You'll help them and give them skill and learning, Lord, as only You can do. And we'll be grateful, Lord, and thankful for what You'll do in their situation. As Tanya prepares to come home, give her safety all the way back here to Columbus and back reunited with her family. Lord, we love You. Thank You again for a wonderful day with the people of God in this place. Remind us as we go from our different ways, Lord, that You go with us. Make us mindful of Your presence. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Let's sing it together, shall we? The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my strength. I go to Bible Baptist and I love my church. I go to Bible Baptist and I love my church. I go to Bible Baptist and I love my church. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my strength. God bless you. You're dismissed. Brother and Mrs. Taylor, I need to see you for 1 second if I could. If you didn't get your picture this morning, you'd like to get one tonight. Lindy will be in the fellowship hall. She'll get your picture taken tonight.